Hello, hello. Happy to be virtually present
Yes.
for this talk. I will be talking a little about the data model convergence, which is a new initiative at PNNL. And then I will dive into a couple of projects, one inside this initiative that I'm leading, and another one which is a DARPA project that is a direct follow-up to the work that I'm doing. And hopefully, seeing the talks so far, you'll find interesting ideas that you are developing and opportunities to collaborate, because we are, of course, very open in looking for a good partnership to bring the work forward. So the first few slides will discuss the definition of DMC. These slides come from Dr. Gimenga, which is our PCSD, the physical sciences and physical and computational science directorate. He's the chief computing scientist for the directorate in which I work, and he's leading the initiative. So these are kind of the introduction of the general framework in which our work is all inserted. What is DMC? The idea is that many of the problems in contemporary science and in engineering, these are problems, of course, that PNNL as a national lab faces, but also DOE and really all our high performance computing scientific research area is facing. All these problems require an integration of high performance computing, large scale data analytics, and machine learning methods. So all three really are now present and need to be used to solve the problem. And integrating all these problems together, that's what the data model convergence really is for us. And of course, the challenge here is that the various frameworks that we have available, they don't really integrate well these three aspects. So DMC as an initiative is really trying to bridge all the three areas together. And this, of course, supports directly one of the lab objectives. Of course, is an initiative spread by the lab that is accelerating the scientific discovery through extreme scale data analytics and simulation. But it tries to really go over that, because it's looking at implementing hardware software co-design to solve the problems that really face the nation and humanity now. These are the, you can see the three different stacks in current approaches, they are really separated. If you think, for example, to data analytics, a lot of the frameworks are looking at using Spark, using Giraffe, using Apache tools to do data analytics. And on the other end, we have, for example, our methods with scientific simulation. For scientific simulation that use MPI-based libraries or PGAS interfaces, for example, you can think. I think, Marek, you were doing the example of NWChem. NWChem is a very interesting application, very, very, very widely used, but it's really a scientific simulation application. Of course, in quantum chemistry, you can use a lot of methods that use machine learning to solve some of the problems now. And the current infrastructure of NWChem is not completely amenable to this integration. So in DMC, what we hope is that applications like NWChem and other framework that use data analytics can be integrated in a continuous flow in which you can simulate the data, perform data analytics, perform machine learning, train your models, and then back in a very virtuous cycle. And the approach that we are using is the one of the lead user. The lead user is a concept from the Democratizing Innovation by Eric von Hippel. And the idea is that as lead user, you set what you are you are making requests on what you need, right? And so, in a sense, as a national lab, we have the opportunity to be connected to domain scientists that are facing problems for which they need new and novel hardware and software solution to solve those problems. So that's the idea is that the lab itself is a lead user and has specific requests that the computer scientists can try to cope and solve with new techniques. And of course, another important aspect in this is the open source world that enables really cooperative hardware software co-design now. There is open source hardware beside the open source software. So really the idea is having this opportunity to contribute to frameworks that are available and leverage also those frameworks that are available. And the other aspect of the approach is really having an holistic co-design. Again, one of the benefits of a national lab is you have the domain scientist, you have the computer scientist. So you can really emphasize what are the requirements and the solutions that you need. Vendors provide extremely great solution, but they don't have right now the insight and the application. So we can, in a sense, lead with the prototypes and the requests also towards the vendors. Oh, we need this feature, right? Because the application, the domain scientist and the application requires this feature. So that's the idea. And one of the objectives of the initiative is really also inside the lab to enable us to establish this inside and also outside, of course, this multidisciplinary collaboration so that we can develop advanced design concepts. And then this design concept, of course, can be shared with the community and with the vendors so that we can have really what can be the post-Moore law architectures, at least an idea on what they should look like. And again, on the DMC, DMC right now is organizing the different initiative trust. We have a domain application, the trust, of course, that defines the challenge problems and will deliver the actual capabilities to the domain scientist. We have a trust devoted to domain-aware machine learning, which will look at bridging the gap between the models and the scalable approach to scientific machine learning. And one of the mandate of this trust is not only to deliver the tools, but also the new theory that is needed to bridge this gap. There is then the software stack, which is kind of the meat for us computer scientists of this initiative, which really looks at what is this programming framework that combines data, HPC, and machine learning. And there are a few, already few of the frameworks available. For example, the SHAD data structures library, the scalable high performance computing and algorithms library that are available based on C++ that try to really start to bridge this gap and are already usable. And then there is the hardware architecture part. Which focus are looking at the novel architectures to improve the system efficiency and the performance. And here the idea is to deliver the tools to do the design, but also some concept designs for this next generation architecture. So to give some example, for the domain application, the research area of interest right now is really looking at addressing decision to making and discovering under uncertainty the applications that really need this convergence. So one of the areas that we are trying to address is the power grid. but also environmental remediation, cybersecurity, and molecule synthesis can be part of this, and can really are starting to show the need to put together scientific simulations with machine learning and data analytics. And in fact, the first example that we have is Power Grid. And this was actually one of the first tasks that was established in this domain area. Here you can see beside the details that are listed in the slides, really, this is a problem that has very different sides to look at. Controlling the grid means short time scale response, moderate time scale response, and long time scales optimization. And all of this part require different algorithms and require different infrastructures. The data volume is also very high, but on the other hand, you can distribute a lot of this with IoT sensors, right? We are talking a lot about what can be monitored at the edge, and how much of the data that you get at the edge needs to be filtered so that you can have an efficient high-performance computing simulation. So this is one of the challenge application really that we are looking at. In the area of domain-aware machine learning, the idea is that we really try to put together ways to embed the domain knowledge. So we need knowledge representation for machine learning, the integration of domain knowledge, and support really data-driven scientific discovery altogether. And we need methods to accelerate the convergence and the stability of the machine learning algorithms, especially when you don't have data that are labeled. So you need the ways to really find what is the probability that the next data or the connected data pertains to a certain category. You can think examples of graph neural networks, right, that are now used for natural language prediction or natural language recognition, when you don't exactly know what is the meaning when you build your graph of the next word, but then because you are building the machine learning algorithm, there is an understanding and classification also for that word that gets predicted. In the area of the software stack research area, the research area of interest is broad because there is a part that is devoted to the software runtimes. Of course, at PNNL, we did a lot of work on asynchronous task-based and data flow function distributed Bazard method, and a lot of work also to support with our runtimes, custom runtimes, novel hardware, processing in network and moving compute to data. And one of the example of our runtimes, of course, was a collaboration with DataVortex. We have an example of an asynchronous active message runtime working on the DataVortex networks. And of course, there is also an aspect of security and privacy because Power Grid is one of the objective, and Power Grid has challenges in terms of security. The other aspect is, of course, architectures now are going towards having accelerators of all types, extremely specialized, and we needed to find efficient programming methodologies. One aspect that is a lot of interest for me in particular, and you see in the next slides when I present the project that I'm directly leading, it's how do you generate this custom accelerator, the synthesis of custom hardware? We don't want, of course, domain scientists to deal with the complexity of generating the accelerator. We don't want the programmers to write the very long code. We want the programmers to focus on the problem domain. It's really a software problem bridging this gap and generating the accelerator. Of course, we need to coordinate and distribute, again, runtime aspects. The other question, of course, if you start using non-von-Neumann architecture, how do you integrate this non-von-Neumann architecture with the conventional architectures? I mean, general purpose processors are still going to stay here. Maybe not, they won't do anymore the bulk of the computation, but they will be there and stay and coordinate the system. And of course, data movement is the other name, the big thing here, because it's kind of the constraining factor for power right now. We can probably convene on that. It's also it needs also software support. Making efficient data communication and data movement needs also software support and efficient software support. And of course, we have the part that requires the optimization of the algorithms. So I speed up. Given that we have also our hardware part that is looking at the prototyping, so it's bridging what the architecture, the software runtimes and the software synthesis will generate. So the idea is really to enable the design space exploration of what we get from the software runtime, from the applications, and find at this point the right target architectures. It's part of the synthesis, of course, but it's also part, if you have a set of accelerators, then how do you select among those accelerators which are the best for the workload that you are doing? And this ties into the initiative with the test beds, again, some of the data vortex system, for example, in other cases, all the different near memory architectures that you are starting to have in other cases, FPGAs or coarse-grained configurable arrays. And that's pretty much all for the overview of the initiative. The idea is that, again, we want DMC to be a way to position PNNL to see what is in high-performance computing beyond the Moore's Law computing world. So, and we think that this can be done only using hardware software co-design and collaboration among the domain scientists, the computer scientists, and the hardware architects. And now, slightly move on a specific project. Here, you can see my point why. After looking at DMC and all these requests that mix together machine learning, graph algorithms, dense and sparse linear algebra together, memory and computation-bound applications, we can have a fully custom accelerator that are kind of unflexible but very efficient. We can have general-purpose processors that supports pretty much all the cases, but are not really very optimized for a single workload, right? GPUs are kind of in between. They are difficult to program. They provide speed ups with certain workloads more and more, honestly, but still not as much as we would like, right? Potentially, the configurable architectures here can play a role, because you can really configure the hardware to support whatever workload you have. So few talks on coarse-grained configurable array, right? That's really what you would like. Of course, managing reconfigurable architectures is kind of a challenge due to the lack right now of efficient software tool chains. We did a lot of steps forward for supporting this type of architectures, but still, it's kind of very sectorialized, right? It goes back to the problems of DMC. We have a stack to do machine learning. We have a stack to do data analytics. We have a stack to do high performance computing, even for reconfigurable architectures and in particular for FPGAs. So the software really, what is the right software to do data model convergence for a configurable architecture? And the other aspect is we probably need to go beyond field programmable gate arrays because sure, they are showing some success now because of this request of specialization, but you cannot really exploit short reconfiguration time. They need to be programmed at the bit level, and reconfiguration is kind of long. And definitely, they are not going because they are configurable. They cannot reach the same peak flop rates of the fixed accelerator. You get the advantage on the efficiency side. So we would like really to go over and beyond what an FPGA can do now. So to address these two key gaps, we are proposing the software-defined architecture for data analytics, so the Square project. You can see from the picture, right? This is a graph together with the matrix representation and tables, because your data are going to be in tables, but you can connect those tables with the graph. So you see already, even just for the data analytics side, two different type of behaviors. The same architecture is not going to cope well with both the type of data that you are dealing with. So you need to devise a tool chain to support this type of different behaviors, targeting an architecture that can configure itself and deal in the best possible conditions with both the type of workloads. And to do this, we propose this. We are working actually on this tool chain. We call it SODA Square, and it's pretty much a compiler, but with a very specific focus, right? We are looking at what are the right abstractions and data-aware analysis that you need to integrate at the front end. So, for example, things that we are looking at is how do we extend the TensorFlow to support more graph-like operations, or how do we bridge Julia with the reconfigurable architectures? Of course, you are designing for a configurable architecture, so you need to do design space exploration to choose what are the right configurations that for each of the work units you need to map on the architecture. And this is done within the compiler options that, and there are many that you can explore. And some of the algorithms that you are looking at are uncoupling optimization or genetic algorithm, because you really need heuristics. You cannot do all this exploration with methods that are brute force because the problems are NP complete. And of course, to manage the configuration that you need some part at runtime to schedule and map the compiled codes on the target architectures. And ideally, we start seeing this in a lot of the available new commercial architectures, reconfigurable architectures, CGRAs, methods to monitor what is happening and send back the information to the compiler tool chain so you can regenerate the configurations depending on what is actually running. And as I was saying, the idea is really looking at forward-looking architectures, so coarse-grained, quickly reconfigurable arrays, so that you can effectively map the different phase of the program on these architectures. There are now some of these architectures available, but they are mostly focused on machine learning. So one of the thing is understanding, oh, how do they deal with graphs and how do they deal with high performance computing system? And on the other end, we have a lot of work done on FPGAs, so we can leverage for now at least FPGAs as prototypes with overlays, right? We had the previous talk, and synthesizing the accelerators on the FPGAs to see what we are actually obtaining. And a summary, right, of SODA Square, the idea is really to provide an integrated toolchain to make the reconfigured architecture viable for this domain, for this data model convergence application. And you need to investigate high-level abstraction to methods to co-optimize the hardware and the software and explore the runtime and the architecture so that you can have the hardware in the loop when you perform the optimization. And clearly, you can see that government, industry, academia are becoming back again interested in a reconfigured architecture as an alternative to the highly custom architectures that we are starting to see now. And I have a just very simple example. This is a Sparkle query, right? We have a compiler that generates the Sparkle query as a set of parallel pattern matching graph pattern matching routines, and we synthesized a custom accelerator for that using our tool. You can see an example of the code that gets generated with OpenMP annotation and the architecture template that the tool customly creates. And the template is configurable, of course, depending on the requirements of the various queries. Can be configured in terms of memory channels, in terms of workers, in terms of the memory banks that you have available, and in terms of number of threads that each of the worker runs, because this is kind of a memory-bound workload. So you really want methods to tolerate latencies rather than reduce that. And this is all automatically generated by the tool. And we did some tests. I don't go in the details. I just want to emphasize that we went through different generation of this architecture. And what we really can see is that with this hardware software co-design approach, we could really generate the custom architectures for each of the different queries, maximizing the metrics that we are interested in. Again, it's a graph application, really. It's a graph query. So we developed all the techniques to generate the accelerators to maximize the memory bandwidth. And I have just two slides to as a tie-in for the DARPA project that came out already from the work that we are doing on SODA Square. And appropriately, the project is called the SODALITE, Software-Defined Accelerator for Machine Learning Tools Environment. This project is part of the DARPA Real-Time Machine Learning Program. It's a 3 years program with 2 phases of 1 year and a half each. We technically are at the 6 months, but it counts like the first quarter because of the emergency right now. And the interesting thing is that it's coordinated with the parallel National Science Foundation program. As national labs, we cannot participate in those programs, but we can collaborate with them. And it's very nice because we can really do the hardware software co-design together with them, as I was emphasizing also for the DMC initiative. And the idea is to develop really a compiler from the machine learning frameworks to to Verilog, starting from, again, PyTorch, TensorFlow, Caffe, or TensorFlow. And differently from SODA Square that looks at reconfigured hardware, in this case, the Verilog will be fabricated in chiplets. And this is just an overview, but you can see some of the common elements with SODA Square and some of the different elements. The idea is really to start from the application requirements. In this case, it's high bandwidth imaging because, again, the chiplets are thought to be used for drones mainly. But we are also thinking what can be applied to the power grid in terms of graph neural networks and other aspects that are still very interesting. Again, this is a compiler. So from the machine learning tools, you have already high-level intermediate representations in which you can do very interesting optimizations. But from that, you can still lower to another compiler intermediate representation. Typically, it's LLVM-IR. The compiler that we are developing is actually integrated into LLVM. So to really have a full stack that can support this type of application. And our synthesizer is also based on the architectural templates, similar to the example that I did with the query. In this case, we are also looking at what are the most promising architectural templates to accelerate the machine learning and specific algorithms of machine learning so that we can fill in and have a unique system in which, sure, you can't generate the accelerator because you don't have the architectural template. No, you can. It's using typical high-level synthesis technique, but it's going to still be effective and work with at least an hardware prototype that you can look at and improve iteratively. And again, these are the three synthesis approaches that we are integrating. As I was saying, the unoptimized components, where we have the critical functional units, for example, tensor operators, but it's terrible, again, like a sample for the query. The conventional HLS, where we have the final state machine with the data pattern that can exploit the existing solution and that can be also recursive, meaning that you can generate with HLS a component that then becomes part of the library and just you keep reusing that, and the ways to support the parallel regions with spatial replications and the dynamics dispatcher, which is similar to the query synthesis. And again, we can, while we develop this new LLVM-based tool, we can leverage, and you can go actually download and test some of these things in an open source tool that we worked on first as students and then now as researchers at PNNL. It's a tool from Politecnico di Milano, Panda. And I think this was all. Sorry if I've been a little long. Try to give an overview of what we are doing in general in the initiative and the two projects that I'm leading. And of course, I'm happy to get feedback and questions, ideas for collaborations, and want to thank Marek and the organizer for inviting me. It's great to be here, even virtually.
Yes, thank you, Antonino. That was very interesting. Of course, the kind of work is such a high abstraction level and very interesting goals, design goals, and the philosophy behind that. So now we are waiting for maybe one or two questions, very quick questions. The floor is open. So you on one of the charts, you had Harvard University engaged in the sort of lower levels, sort of close to silicon design, and PNNL is in a very high level, abstraction level. So, what is the mechanism of building a relationship? So, collaboration. I wanted to collaborate. You know that there are nowadays
yes
there's very Europe Eurocentric. You know, we have European funding, we collaborate in Europe, and if I wanted to collaborate with the US or in specifically PNNL, what should I do?
That's a good question. Probably it's not my pay grade, but definitely projects there are plans to be collaborative, at least from the research point of view. The funding part is a little more complicated right now. We try to participate as much as possible, I would say, in review panels, for example, for European projects, we are a consultant. One of the easiest way, of course, is having students coming and getting this collaboration started. And we hope in the future to start more and more of these collaborations. For Japan, I'm not sure for Europe, but the new initiatives on high performance computing see a direct influence from national US national labs. So again, I don't have a specific answer on the specific way to establish collaborations, but I can see that hopefully as soon as we reopen all the borders, we will have ways to start also attracting the funding to the having this shared initiative.
Right.
So I see a lot of questions here.
Just one question from Carol.
It's in the moderated way.
Oh, there's okay. One from Jan.
Okay.
It looks like all my students are asking questions. That's nice.
Okay, so regarding partnership for academia and industry, so I didn't say that, but in real-time machine learning, I'm actually working with Harvard University, Professor David Brooks and Professor Guyong Wei. This also answers the part of the RTML design. They are the ones, as Marek was aptly pointing, my team is much more on the Verilog, designing the Verilog architecture and targeting FPGAs. The most logic synthesis part, most of the logic synthesis part is instead done at Harvard right now, including the generation of the GDS2 files that then will be taped out, and DARPA will support the taping out of the chiplets. And regarding the training for RTML, our expectation is yes, that the chiplets will also allow to do training. We have in mind some of the designs in which we will have control processors that will manage the accelerators so that you can actually build the task graph, the execution task graphs coming from the machine learning when you need to do training. And then modify what we are calling it technically an HTG driven, hierarchical task graph driven computation, which is a mix of data flow with the hierarchical properties. But I'd be happy to discuss the details, but short answer is yes, we want to allow for training.
Okay, Antonino, I think we need to let Jay to enter the stage, and thank you very much. That's great. So I hope everything is fine on your side of the world, and